Hello everyone. For tonight, we're going to spend the next hour or so in the tranquility of Broceliande Forest, in the company of characters you know of: King Arthur, his wife Guinevere, Merlin, Sir Lancelot and Sir Galahad, the Lady of the Lake, or Morgan le Fay. And we will also discuss the Knights of the Round Table, Excalibur, Camelot, Avalon, or the quest for the Holy Grail. All this mythology that we've all heard about and that keeps appearing in novels or films, where does it come from? And is it based only on fiction, or is there some reality to it? How old is it, and why did it last for so long? Because all these names I just mentioned, they were already famous 600 or 700 years ago, in the Middle Age. So there is going to be some storytelling tonight, because we like stories, and some history too. We will try to understand what this Arthurian mythology is about. We will go to regions and countries like England, Wales, Scotland, Brittany. We will go back in time to the 5th century when the Roman Empire crumbled. We will talk about British and French literature and many more things. So it is now time for you to get ready for this slow and relaxing ride. You need to sit or lay down comfortably. You may shut your eyes whenever you wish, because the visuals are not necessary to follow along. Put your headsets on, and you will be ready for our journey to a world of legend and magic. Once upon a time, a long, long, long time ago, the island of Britain fell into chaos after the Roman Empire disappeared. Under the Romans, Britain was prosperous and safe. But with the empire gone, barbarian invasions began, cities declined, villages were looted, and no part of the country remained safe. Britons waited desperately for a savior, and King Arthur of the Britons appeared. He led his army and his knights across the country to re-establish peace and restore authority upon the land. Then, with his gorgeous and blonde wife, Guinevere, he ruled the new kingdom from his castle of Camelot, helped by Merlin the Wizard and his knights of the Round Table. Arthur was feared by his enemies and loved by his people, and his knights were bound to him by a code of chivalry. Together, they defeated the plans of evil sorceress Morgan and even started the ultimate quest for glory and faith, the search for the Holy Grail. Under these benevolent characters, the kingdom was kept always safe, despite countless events, internal and external threats, adventures, romance, magic. Arthur owned Excalibur. He his legendary sword. According to some accounts, he pulled the sword from an anvil sitting atop a stone, and being the only one accepted by the sword, he gained legitimacy to be the one true king. In other versions, Excalibur was given to him by the Lady of the Lake, Vivian, an enchantress who was also the fairy godmother to Sir Lancelot and helped Merlin. As Arthur approached the end of his life, after he had been wounded by his traitorous nephew, Mordred, he was transported to the legendary island of Avalon, and nobody ever saw him again. So maybe he could return one day. So this is the tale, the legend, and you may have heard it like this, or with the same characters, but playing different roles, or with a different course of events. Because this entire story has been elaborated, constructed over hundreds of years, and long after it supposedly happened. It all comes from medieval treatises and novels written in England and France, starting more than 1,000 years ago. Even if you are not familiar with King Arthur, you certainly recognized details, because these stories are like a matrix for tales of chivalry, fairy tales, and fantasy stories in general. Works that were written or created long after used the same stereotypes and narratives, take traditional fairy tales like Snow White, Lord of the Rings, or Indiana Jones and Star Wars. They all owe something to these Arthurian legends. So I will tell you more stories from them in a moment. But first, let's take a look at Great Britain in the 5th century and this whole body of literature that created the mythology, to see what roots it may have in real history, in real facts. From the 1st to the 5th century, the Roman Empire occupied a large part of Great Britain, not all of it. Scotland remained independent and was never occupied. First, because the Scots defended their land fiercely, and second, because it was very far and not particularly strategic for Rome to occupy Scotland. So, at some point, at the beginning of the 2nd century, Rome accepted to fix its northern frontier close to what is currently the England-Scotland frontier, a long and famous fortification, a wall called Hadrian's Wall, after Emperor Hadrian, was built from the North Sea to the Irish Sea. The efficiency of this wall to serve as a frontier was uncertain, because it is 80 miles long and impossible to garrison entirely. So the wall was never entirely invasion-proof. But this was not really the point. It reflected Rome's policy in the 2nd century of turning more defensive, because the empire was facing troubles in various parts of its huge territory, including in regions very far away, like Egypt. And it was also a political kind of building. It showcased the extraordinary wealth, engineering capabilities, and human resources of Rome. And speaking of wealth and engineering, Rome provided the occupied parts of Great Britain, England and Wales, with an unknown level of security and prosperity for four centuries. With Rome arrived roads, international trade, modern cities, more land was claimed for agriculture, and like in many other parts of the Roman Empire, the living conditions improved dramatically for the population. People were mostly protected from raids, there was no civil war, and everyday life improved for every social class, including the lowest ones like poor peasants. Troops were stationed constantly, and they very efficiently deterred troubles or invasions. And this lasted for generations, like in Gaul or in Spain, until the Roman Empire started to crumble, especially its western part, and it withdrew from its most distant provinces. In the 5th century, this is what happened to Great Britain. The Roman presence vanished, and Britons found themselves an attractive prey to the so-called barbarians living around. They were the Irish. Rome never conquered Ireland, and the Irish started raiding regularly the western coast of Great Britain. From the north came the Scots and the Picts. To defend themselves, Britons invited mercenaries, Saxon and Angle mercenaries. These were Germanic tribes coming across the North Sea. But this backfired quickly, and these tribes became invaders too, plunging most of Great Britain in complete chaos. This period marks the beginning of the Dark Ages, which is a period of several centuries that started with the fall of the Roman Empire in Western Europe. The same happened in Italy, in Spain, in France, and parts of Germany. The economy collapsed. Technology and knowledge was lost. Cities became much smaller. And it is also likely that the population fell. But despite all these hardships, something happened in the 5th century. Because by the end of it, after several decades of chaos, the situation somewhat improved, and a degree of peace was restored. This raises the possibility that a providential man, maybe a Roman, maybe a Briton, managed to bring back a bit of order. But we don't know precisely who or how. And there are several candidates. It could be one of them or a combination of them that provided a basis for the legendary King Arthur. There is no compelling evidence from the 5th century about this. As far as we know, the name Arthur appeared for the first time several centuries later in a Welsh poem from the beginning of the Middle Age. This text was written by a monk at the beginning of the years 800, so we are already 300 years later. And the name Arthur is mentioned not as a king, but as a military leader who fought along the kings of the Britons and would have guided an army in a series of victorious battles against the Saxons and forced them to retreat. Another theory is that Arthur was Roman. He would have been inspired by a man called Riotamus or Arturius, who lived in Britain during this post-Roman period, and he would also have fought against invaders. It is well possible that a strong man, or several, emerged at the end of the 5th century, but historians did not find any solid evidence to it. Actually, in Britain, like in many European countries, the 5th, 6th and 7th centuries are among the least well known, because as the Dark Ages name suggests, these were chaotic centuries. By many counts, civilization receded, few documents were written, and many were lost. Waves of invasions destroyed a lot, and there are barely any architectural traces in Western Europe, because no large stone buildings were started. After the early 800s, we know that the name of Arthur is mentioned in tales from Wales and Brittany. So this time we are outside Great Britain. Brittany is the most western region of France, but it was not part of France back then. It became an independent kingdom in the Middle Age, then a duchy, and it joined the Kingdom of France much later. And in these tales, Arthur is a hero, a great warrior, who defended Britain from all sorts of enemies, human or supernatural enemies. But he was alone. There is no known mention of other characters alongside him. The true basis for the Arthurian mythology that really established him as a known figure beyond these local stories is a book from the 12th century. So this is another 300 years leap, and this time we are almost midway between Arthur's supposed time and today. This book is called History of the Kings of Britain. The real title is Historia Regum Britanniae, because it was in Latin, and its author is Geoffrey of Monmouth, a British cleric. No historian takes this book seriously as a history book. It is a fictional account of British history. The book starts with the mythical founding of the British nation by Trojans, and it continues over 2,000 years until the Anglo-Saxons took control of most of Britain. This happened in the 7th century. The value of this book is not as a history book, because it is widely inaccurate. A large part of it was just invented or inspired by legends. But it is a valuable piece of medieval literature, not only for the Arthurian legend. Another character, which is purely fictional, appeared in History of the Kings of Britain, King Lear. King Lear is famous today, mainly because Shakespeare used this mythical king character. Despite being purely fictional, History of the Kings of Britain was was very popular in the 12th century and was even translated to various languages. And it was even considered to be a serious history book by many people until the end of the Middle Age. Now, a popular book in these times doesn't mean it could reach the entire population. Far from that. Books were handwritten, mostly in monasteries, and they were accessible to a very small population of educated monks, clerics, librarians, and nobles. So the definition of a successful book in the Middle Age was maybe a few dozen copies and a few hundred readers or a few thousands. It doesn't mean it reached popular culture at all, but still, from this small base of readers, the most striking and memorable parts of a story could trickle down and tens of thousands of persons could hear about it. So in this fictional work, the author introduces a father to Arthur, Uther Pendragon. He tells that after the Romans left Britain, the Britons looked for a monarch that could defend them. And the Archbishop of London turned to the Kingdom of Brittany. He offered the throne of Britain against protection for the Britons. The brother of the King of Brittany accepted. He became King of Britain and had three sons, the youngest of them, Uther Pendragon, father of King Arthur. This story is entirely made up. The Kingdom of Brittany did not exist in the 5th century. It was founded several centuries later. So this is completely anachronistic. And the characters are fictional too. But this is how Arthur gained a father. This is how the story goes. Uther Pendragon was only the youngest son, so not the heir. His elder brother ruled first, but he was weak and he let a growing number of Saxons settle in Britain at the expense of the British. The Saxons ended up taking over the country's major cities, including London and York, and the king had to flee to Snowdonia in Wales, where he tried to build a fortress. But the fortress could not be built because stones kept sinking into the ground, and it appeared that the only solution to start laying the foundations of this fortress would be to sprinkle the blood of a boy with no father on the stones. A boy with no father is no common thing, of course, but the king's envoys found one, allegedly conceived by a spirit. His name was Merlin. Now enters the wizard of Arthurian legends. Merlin was smart. He managed to avoid being sacrificed by solving the problem of the sinking stones. There was an underground pool under the chosen site to build the fortress. The pool was emptied, but when it was done, two dragons appeared, one white and one red. The two dragons started fighting. The white one represented the Saxons, and the red one the Britons. And after being dominated, the red one, the Britons, finally won the fight. Merlin saw it as a sign that Saxon dominance in Britain would be overcome. Later, the king perished in a fire, and his brother was poisoned. So the youngest brother, Uther Pendragon, became king. He kept fighting the Saxons during all his reign, but one day, at a court gathering in London, he was suddenly overcome with intense desire for the wife of the Duke of Cornwall, one of his vassals. The Duke sent his wife back to Cornwall in the hope that the king would not take her. But Uther was really into her, and as the Duke refused to deliver his wife, he marched on Cornwall with an army. He defeated the Duke's smaller army, and then took a potion prepared by Merlin, which turned him into an exact likeness of the Duke. He entered the castle where the wife resided, and tricked her into believing he was her husband. She allowed him into her bed, and on this night Arthur was begotten. You understand why this book, History of the Kings of Britain, was such a big success. It is a great story, and this part I told you about is only a small fragment of it. For the readership, 8 centuries ago, this was a wonderful epic, like Lord of the Rings, but on top of this, it was supposed to have actually happened, and it could be credible. Some people may have had their doubts, and could be only half convinced. But this was a time when people believed in magic. They saw the supernatural everywhere, and they had no way of checking whether this was fiction or not, because there were no historical sources accessible. Now, still according to the book, King Uther was finally poisoned by the evil Saxons, but they couldn't stop his son, Arthur, from being crowned. Arthur kept fighting the Saxons, allied with the Picts and the Scots, and finally defeated all of them, opening a period of peace and return of prosperity. He returned land to their rightful owners and rebuilt, and was extraordinarily popular, as people gave him credit for his courage and generosity. He married a woman of Roman descent, Guinevere. Here she enters. The story continues when Arthur has secured his kingdom. So now he goes into Europe, conquers Norway, Denmark, and Gaul, and gathers knights around him. But Rome, which still exists in this alternative story, threatens him because Britain no longer pays tribute, and he refuses to pay tribute. So he leads his army through Gaul and beats the Romans in the region of Burgundy. After that, Arthur plans to pass the Alps and to keep advancing towards Rome, but he receives bad news from home. He had left his nephew, Mordred, in charge of the kingdom, but Mordred usurped the throne and started to live in adultery with Guinevere. Arthur returns home, and a new battle follows, during which Mordred is killed, and Arthur fatally wounded. After this battle, Arthur is taken to the island of Avalon, which is a vague, mythical place, and he never came back from it, so we can suppose he died there, or did he? So the history of the kings of Britain was published in 1136, and it laid the foundations of the literary King Arthur, introducing places, events, and a few characters. But the legend was still a long way from what it became in the following three centuries. The next step happened in France and was invented by a poet called Chrétien de Troyes a few decades later. Chrétien de Troyes has been called the inventor of the modern novel by some historians of literature, because he wrote stories that could be fictional and were intended to purely tell a story. We find it the most basic concept in storytelling nowadays, but prior to the 12th century, no novels, as we understand the term today, were ever written. Stories could be told in chronicles or treatises or essays, but the intention to write a book or just a short story for the sake of storytelling was absent before this period. Modern storytelling in novels means that a story, however short or long it is, has a structure. There is a beginning, a build-up in the middle, and a climax followed by a conclusion. It forms a system, and it cannot end in the middle of the action without resolving plot points. When this happens, and unless it is intentional, we just consider it poor or unfinished writing. Anyway, Chrétien de Troyes added new elements, building on the writings by Geoffrey of Monmouth, the author of History of the Kings of Britain, and adding various characters, including one of the most famous, Lancelot, Sir Lancelot. Lancelot is a brave and handsome knight, but he can be weak with women sometimes, and he begins an affair with Guinevere while serving Arthur, creating a love triangle. In the history of the Kings of Britain, Guinevere was already guilty of letting the kingdom slip into civil war by accepting Mordred. And here she is again, threatening peace and her marriage with this affair. She has been depicted under different lights, depending on the authors, but often as a threat or even a villain. This was not uncommon in medieval stories, including in all these stories of chivalry, where a knight accomplishes extraordinary things to seduce a lady. Women were praised as long as they remained modest, beautiful, and loyal to their husband and their house. As soon as they stepped out of the way, disasters happened, and not only for them, for the entire society. Women were dangerous in literature and popular stories. Of course, this echoes the myth of Adam and Eve, where Eve is responsible for the original sin and the fall of humanity. But obviously, it also reflects the very patriarchal society of the Middle Age. And it was also a cautionary tale. These stories were written by men, almost always men, and mainly for men. even less women than men had the education to read. You could find some in the nobility or at the head of a monastery, but otherwise they would know about these stories only through oral storytelling or when they were adapted into a theater show or songs. The other main addition by Chrétien de Troyes is the quest for the Holy Grail. In one of his latest works, called Percival, the Story of the Grail, he introduced a golden grail. A grail was a serving dish, not a goblet. And this is the story. Percival was raised by his mother in the forests of Wales. And one day, he encountered a group of knights and decided he wanted to be one of them. So he headed to King Arthur's court to be trained. One day, as he headed back to the forest where his mother lived, he met the Fisher King. The Fisher King, or Wounded King, was the last of a long line charged with keeping various artifacts, including the Holy Grail. He had been wounded, so he could not stand, and all he could do was fish in a small boat near his castle. And he waited for the one chosen noble that could heal him. The Golden Grail kept him alive, waiting for this moment. And of course, the chosen one was Percival. In original stories involving the quest for the Grail, Percival is the central character, and he joins other knights around King Arthur's round table. But later, in French and English novels, he is replaced by another knight, Galahad. Like Geoffrey of Monmouth, Chrétien de Troyes was a successful author. We know it thanks to the dozens of copies of his writings that have survived until now. The stories were also translated and made the Arthurian legend even more popular. A follower of Chrétien de Troyes, Robert de Boron, introduced Broceliande, a mythical forest located somewhere in Brittany. In one of his poems, Broceliande becomes the forest where Merlin is buried, and in further stories, Broceliande is the place where the evil Morgan le Fay traps knights in the Vale of No Return until they are freed by Lancelot. Broceliande was famous as an enchanted forest before it was associated with Arthur. In medieval Europe, it had a reputation as a place of mystery and magic. Enchanted forests tend to be a recurring theme in fantasy. Many fantasy novels have one, and Broceliande is the original literary enchanted forest. So it does not really have a location, but there is a forest in Brittany, the Pimpon Forest, which has often been associated with Broceliande. It started to receive tourists in the 19th century, and nowadays there are neo-pagan circles that gather and perform ceremonies there. So, all these texts we mentioned, they became a big piece of British and French literature in the 13th and 14th centuries. They were like what we call classics today. They are a central piece of what scholars call the matter of Britain and the matter of France, that is to say, the founding literature of the two countries. It is during this period of the Middle Age that authors started to write in their own language, no longer only in Latin. This is how a national literature appeared, and these works that built the Arthurian mythology were among the first works of fiction to be translated into other languages so that they could reach a broader audience. Speaking of this, the next founding text of Arthurian literature is also considered to be the first novel written in English. It is called Le Mort d'Arthur. The title is in Middle French. It means the death of Arthur. In modern French, it should be La Mort d'Arthur. But the text was written in Middle English. Not exactly the English spoken today, so modern editions include a modernized form of English that makes it easier to understand. However, even though Middle English can be disturbing because of the spelling of words, it is readable by any English speaker. Le Mort d'Arthur was written in the 15th century, by the very end of the Middle Age, and its author is Sir Thomas Malory. In a sense, it is the Bible of Arthurian legend, because it is the compilation and reworking of existing tales. Thomas Malory gathered about all that had been published since the 12th century, translated the French parts into English, made a few additions, and contrary to the manuscripts I mentioned before, it was printed in 1485, not long after it was written. It was popular, and now with the beginning of book printing in Europe, at the end of the Middle Age, a successful book could be printed thousands of times, so the diffusion became much broader. The book is made of 8 different parts that follow Arthur from his birth to his last battle, and details dozens of side stories involving other characters, especially the Knights of the Round Table. Thomas Malory tells how Arthur was born from Uther Pendragon, became King of Britain after he removed the sword from the stone, and accomplishes military prowesses with the help of Merlin. Morgan le Fay is his sister, and she betrays by turning against him, and so does his nephew, Mordred. Then Arthur marries Guinevere and inherits the Round Table from her father, and he creates a fellowship of knights that he gathers around the table. There are many anachronic elements here, because the code of chivalry and all the weapons and armors that the knights use are contemporary to Sir Thomas Malory. This is all from the late Middle Age, and clearly could not have existed 1,000 years before. But this is not the point, because the book is a novel and does not try to be taken for a compilation of facts. But it doesn't mean it is separated from its time. The book was written during the Wars of the Roses. I made a story about it long ago, by the way. I'll put the link in the description. So, all along, the book reflects a preoccupation about order, legitimacy, and how some threaten it by trying to rise to power violently. But once Arthur has pacified his kingdom, he marches on Rome, and he is even crowned Roman Emperor after defeating Roman armies. But instead of staying there, he returns to Britain. Among all his knights, the most admired is Lancelot, and his behavior is perfect. He is the most loyal, the bravest, and he is always ready to assist ladies in distress. But Lancelot struggles between his chivalry code and the complexity of the world, where it is not always obvious what action is going to serve the greater good. He is enchanted by Morgan Le Fay and falls for Guinevere. As the story advances, various knights embark on the quest for the Holy Grail, including Lancelot, Percival, and Bors. But eventually the quest is completed by Galahad. Galahad is a model of perfection and purity. He lives a faithful life without sin, and this is what makes him achieve the quest. Whereas, however virtuous the other knights are, they cannot reach this perfection given by faith. And in particular, Lancelot. At some point, the adultery of Guinevere is revealed, and Arthur condemns her to death. She has to be burned alive. But blinded by love, Lancelot breaks the rules and saves her, and kills several other knights in the process. Then he escapes to France. Arthur pursues him, and when he's gone, Mordred takes the throne and control of the kingdom. So Arthur returns to Britain and participates in his last battle, where Mordred dies, but Arthur is injured, and he is taken on a boat with Excalibur to Avalon. And this is just the main storyline of La Mort d'Arthur, because there are plenty of side stories and characters. The novel was a success and remains the reference today for Arthurian mythology. But it was almost forgotten by the end of the 16th century. And so was King Arthur. The Middle Age had ended, and the following period rejected everything medieval, chivalry, as it was known, completely disappeared. The world expanded dramatically beyond Europe with the exploration of the world, and medieval customs, architecture, literature were ignored or even rejected for being supposedly naive, old-fashioned. In general, they were perceived as coming from a dark age. Also, the medieval audience read these stories as half fiction, half history. And as I told you before, the history of the kings of Britain was regarded by many almost as a history book. In the 16th and 17th century, it became obvious that they were not reliable, and when historians revisited the documents and realized this, that there was nothing accurate in the writings of Geoffrey of Monmouth, Chrétien de Troyes, or Thomas Malory. The reputation of these books decreased even further. The Arthurian legend was not completely forgotten. It was never entirely forgotten, but it had a small audience and nothing outside Britain, whereas it was an European phenomenon from the 12th to the 15th century. This lasted until the 19th century, when the interest in medieval culture, romanticism, and what is called the Gothic Revival happened. So in the 19th century, all this mythology became popular again and served as inspiration for novels that sold well. Le Morte d'Arthur was published again and became a classic. The legend served as inspiration in paintings. It influenced a lot all this fantasy literature until today, then movies, and today we all know Arthur, Merlin, Excalibur, or Lancelot because of this revival. After so many centuries of elaboration, and because it has roots in a real period, even though King Arthur may be fictional, the legend has acquired a unique dimension. Modern fantasy novels like Lord of the Rings, for example, or The Song of Ice and Fire may be captivating, but we can never forget that they are works of pure fiction. Arthurian mythology is in a league of its own because it has been around for so long, and because even though it's fiction, it has roots in real history. Our exploration is ending for tonight, and it's now time for you to sleep. Thank you very much for listening today, and I'll speak to you soon about another topic. Au revoir.